Hello, this is Tom O'Kane from Cae Tan CSA. I'm making this video as one of our resources for our Grow Your Own CSA training program. And this particular video is going to be about site planning. So I had a scout around on the internet and I didn't find anything that was kind of relevant enough to the program. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to run through how we laid out our sites just as an example. By no means, we're like the perfect site layout. I'm sure there's people out there who could tell you all sorts of other ideas of site layout in a lot more detail. But I thought just giving you an example of how we concluded our site layout would give a kind of starting position to discuss and think about how you're going to go ahead with your sites. So in considering your site layout, the issues that we have considered, the main issues that we considered, I'd say are these: access to water, aspect and shade, prevailing winds and spring winds, building positions, barns, packing sheds, polytunnels, toilets, tool storage, parking, covered workspace for sun and rain, wild areas, play, relaxation areas, drainage, views, roads and neighbours, and lastly, permaculture zoning, which I do know a little about. I can't say we've applied it in any great detail on our sites, but that could be very relevant for some sites. I'd also say, within considering all these different aspects of your site, ultimately, you're going to go with what feels right. I know for us, there were certain things that, you know, when I walked onto the site, I just felt like, this needs to go there, that needs to go there. If you sort of break it down logically, maybe it's not the best position to put a barn or whatever it is, but actually it just feels right. And there might be some areas that you've got to walk further to get to it. And actually, but when you're there, if that's your main hanging out space, and it's got a beautiful view, I'd probably go for that one rather than the other one. So our two sites are very different. This is our original site down here that we call Webb's Field, which is a 4-acre field. There's very different geology under the two sites. It's hard to see from this, but basically this very green land up here and running around the edge of these trees is actually quite a lot higher than the ground down in the valley here. And this is common land. There's 1,000 acres of common land across here and sort of running north and east and west. That basically is old runoff from glaciers. So it's kind of a mixture of kind of boulder clays and all sorts of random bits of rocks. But there's lots of clay in there. And what's happened thousands of years ago is that clay has kind of settled down and run down these valleys. Right down to the coast, actually. On the coast, you get cliffs full of kind of scree and clay. So what it means for this site is that actually it's a very heavy clay. The top soil is pretty nice for about a spade's depth, but then the rest of the soil is very, very heavy clay. And it means that the upper part of the site here, which is fairly flat, is very waterlogged. This sloping element of the field is fairly free draining, and then the bottom of the field is incredibly wet. And you'll see, I'll show you the video afterwards, we'll walk around the site, but actually we've created wetland and wild areas in the particularly wet parts of the field. And then about 6 fields over is our newest site, which is Furze Hill. This is owned by the Ecological Land Co-op. There's actually 18 acres here, which is owned by the Ecological Land Co-op, and we rent these 5 acres, just that section there. And even though as the crow flies it's pretty close, when we're going back and forth with machinery we tend to have to go all the way around here, either around this way or up this little tiny old lane here and back around there. So there's quite a different distance between the sites, which isn't ideal, but it's just what we've ended up with. But in some ways, I really value the difference in the two sites. This site is incredibly beautiful, surrounded by ancient oak woodland and, and all sorts of mixed broadleaf forest. And this site is much more of a working site, really. Like, we use every inch of the ground. We're working towards transforming it to an agroforestry system at some point, with getting in a lot more trees and windbreaks. But this ground, like I said, this whole area here is very good growing ground. It's sort of a sandy clay loam, probably more clay than anything, and it's overlaying a limestone bed, so it's very free draining. But because it's fairly clay soil, it holds the water really well. So we've got the advantage of the free draining site, and also a rich sort of soil on top, which does hold enough moisture to grow crops really well. The whole 18 acres had been a market garden at some point in the past. The whole 18 acres there had been rotated for a number of years, and then it sort of sat in cereal production and livestock grazing for a long time, and now we put it back into horticultural production. This site over here historically would have been more grazing, and there were potatoes grown in it apparently 30-40 years ago, but for the last 30-40 years it's just been fairly gentle livestock grazing, pretty much sheep getting off the common, or occasionally maybe cattle getting off the common and coming in and grazing the grassland here. So starting with our original site, this isn't an up-to-date photo. This is just something I took off Google Maps. So it's just to give you an idea of how we have laid out the site. North is pretty much kind of that way up there. So this is fairly sort of south facing, and it slopes, this area here slopes to the west. This area is fairly flat, and this area is fairly flat. We chose to put all our polytunnels up the top here. There's actually now 4 polytunnels and a 5th one going in this autumn winter. We chose that site because it was flat, and we wanted them also away from the road. There's a road that runs into the village down here, and we basically, when you look up from the main road through the gate at the bottom, you basically only see the first polytunnel on each side. So even though we've got 5 polytunnels, you have the impression looking in that there's only 2 there, which they had to get planning permission. But I think that was a lot that was on our side, basically. That really helped, that the visual impact wasn't too great. Then we decided, we ummed and ahed actually between running our beds down the field or across the field. And in the end, we opted for across the fields, partly for visual impact, and partly because we didn't want it to drain off too quick. But actually, having worked there a few years, I don't know whether we would have been better off running our beds down the field, so in very wet periods of the year, the water would run away. But it's tricky on this site, because what we find is this slope actually dries out very quickly in a dry period, even though it can be incredibly waterlogged. It's a difficult field to farm. This field, as you can see in this photo, this was during a very dry period. The ground does really dry out, and when it dries, the water drains to the bottom of the field, down to now where we have a pond and willow beds. The top stays fairly damp. That was another reason for having the polytunnels here, that actually it's fairly minimal, our irrigation in the polytunnels. We have, if anything, we've put gutters in, so we've got drains running down the side of these tunnels, some down both sides, some down one side, down all of them, and then into a main drain which runs out and into a gutter in the hedge here. So that's our main sort of layout. You can't see, but we've got a packing shed up here, parking area down this area, and a compost toilet under the trees here. And in, I guess in we had thought ideally, because our parking area is down here, it probably would have been good to have polytunnels, packing shed, toilet, everything sort of fairly close down this end to the parking area. But from up the top here, well, for one thing, it was actually far too wet to put our polytunnels or a barn down there. So we opted for the top area, which is drier, even though it's still not particularly dry. And as we had our polytunnels here, we thought we'd rather have our packing shed there. It means that basically we've got to bring the vehicle right into the top of the field, which is difficult in wet periods. And during really wet periods, we have to barrow produce down to the bottom. But we've kind of got used to it. And as I mentioned earlier, there's also a really beautiful view from here out across the valley. So if we were sitting down here for all our tea breaks, you know, we wouldn't enjoy the sight so much. So we opted to come up the top here. I'll show you some pictures as well of this site in sort of full production at the moment, because the site layout has changed quite a bit since we've got the pond installed and new polytunnel up and everything. Compost toilet we chose to put down in this corner, again for like minimum visual impact and sort of privacy. Our rotations, our pond in the wet area, willow beds in the wet area. We're extending the willow beds right through this wet area of the field. And we've now sort of opted for just a summer rotation in this field, because it's a fairly wet ground, like I said, and we don't really want to be on the ground in winter. We've got summer brassicas, green manures, squash and sweet corn, and we rotate that lot around, which you'll see that from the picture, the more recent picture I'll show you afterwards. Prevailing winds generally come from south, southwest, blowing across this way. We're lucky that along this end, there's a fairly steep hillside, wooded hillside, so it's actually an incredibly sheltered site. So prevailing wind isn't too much of an issue. But what we did notice, particularly in the early years, is that these northerly and northwesterly winds often blow in the early spring when we've got delicate young plants planted out. So that's where we're thinking about. So we have kind of allowed this hedgerow to flourish, and we've built it up. We've planted all sorts of particularly pollinating plants all along this end of the field just to build up this bank. And so early in the year, we get as much growth as we possibly can to break down that cold wind coming in to sort of damage the early crops. So I think tool storage we've got in the sheds here. So all our tools are in actually a tiny little shed, which is probably about 2 meters by 1 meter. And all our tools fit fairly easily in there. All the machinery is actually in the other site. Any machinery we need to use, we bring down to use in this field. Parking, like I mentioned, is down the bottom of the field to keep people, keep vehicles out the way of the site, really. And then covered workspace, sun and rain. We use an area of the polytunnel here, which we keep for hanging out in wet weather and working in wet weather. And there's enough space in there to get school groups in, which I'll show you some pictures of as well. And then in warm weather, we're generally under these huge oak trees, this one in particular, which offers really lovely shade for packing. And our shed, which is under there, also has like a big shade area for packing. And wild areas, basically all of this, we've let go wild. There's a number of ponds in here. All of this, we're kind of letting go wild. And then we've got willow beds, and all the exteriors of the field we're letting go wild. So this site has a lot more wild area, which is really lovely. It brings a lot of diversity to the site, a lot of wildlife, and you know, we haven't seen any negatives to that really. You know, the odd squirrel coming in and stealing strawberries, but we kind of not too bothered by that. Play and relaxation, you know, it's great for kids. We've got a track that runs here into the woods, and kids go off and disappear in the woods and play. We've got a load of dirt jumps down here, so my boy and all his mates race their bikes down here, and they've got about 6 jumps, progressively getting bigger and bigger down the field. There's talk of setting up a half pipe for skating that someone might donate us in the field here. So yeah, you know, there's a lot of scope for fun in this field and engaging people. And I'd say drainage has been an issue. So like I said, we've drained this whole area where the polytunnels are. We've got quite serious drainage on it, taking water out. And we do find this portion of the field, which is fairly flat, gets very waterlogged from water that gets through our drainage system into the top of the field. So we're considering this winter putting in a big ditch and bank along here and draining this whole section away. I think I've touched on views from roads and neighbours. We did have a lot of issues with the neighbours when we set up this site for various historical reasons with the site. So we've been very wary. We've planted actually a tree boundary along the road down here, which, so for most of the year, actually, you don't really see into the field, so it doesn't bother anyone. I'm not quite sure why people are so bothered about seeing a field of vegetables anyway, but they do seem to dislike it, some people. But so basically our visual impact is minimised. Like I said, the polytunnels, you only see two, and it's kind of from the side on. You see this whole sweep of landscape before the polytunnels, so they have very little impact. We did have to go down the route of getting permitted development because we're on a 15-acre site, so we've got rights for permitted development. And I think that's about it for this site. I'll move on then and tell you a bit about how we've laid out the site at Furze Hill. So following looking at the map of Websfield, this is like our original site I'm going to show you around now. I'm just going to give you a little tour. So again, you can see we're on this little country lane, and skinny little country lane again, which we've got a fairly narrow entrance into again. We did widen the entrance here so we could get a lorry in to deliver when we dug out the car park to sort of deliver rubble. So this site we have been on. This site, as I said, is our original site. We've been here now for 7 years. And I said a bit about it before. It's not ideal growing site. There's very wet ground at the bottom, wet ground at the top, and kind of okay ground in the middle. It's lovely soil when it's in the right weather conditions, but it's not an easy bit of land to work. So yeah, starting at the bottom here, one of the first things we did was create this parking area, because we did initially park on the road, and yeah, people didn't like that at all. So we've dug out and put a parking area in, which we can fit about 6 cars or even 8 cars at a squeeze. And then this inner fence and gate defines where our bit of land starts, because we share the property with a group of people who keep sheep, like a sheep share. There's a small veg pickup there just for like 6 local people who are very local to the field. I'll actually show you a little video of our veg pickup afterwards as well, just to show you how that works. As I said, the bottom of the field here is very wet, so we've kind of let this go wild. And just a year ago, well, 2 years ago, we put all the willow in. And then about a year ago, had this pond dug. And it's a pond just for wildlife, really. It's really lovely. It's really, really transforms the site, actually, to have this pond here. Lots of dragonflies, ducks, geese, you know, like, yeah, it becomes a real little haven, little wildlife reserve in the field. And as I said, we leave a lot of the ground around it. We're just gonna leave it wild and see what happens. We planted, I showed you on the map, these trees here, the poplar and willow and alder and cherry. We planted a band about 20, 30 metres thick about 7 years ago. And you can see they're really good height now and shelter the view of the field from the road. So moving on, access is an issue. You know, this ground that I'm walking up now, come the wet months, even in wet months of the summer, you can't drive a car up here. It just gets too slippery, and because it's fairly clay ground. So that is an issue. we could have situated our polytunnels and whatnot down the bottom, but actually the ground was too wet for access. That would have been easier in our packing shed, it would have been easier. But like I said earlier as well, we also wanted, you'll see from the top of the field is a lovely place to hang out. So lovely sweet corn crop and squash crop and courgettes. We've got a huge amount of squash this year because this field is really only suited to the summer crops. So yeah, we're gonna have a massive squash crop this season. And then we've got a bit of buckwheat, green manure. This was all the winter garlic, which is gonna be cultivated and green manured. And then some late beans, which need to be mowed in and green manured. A bit more buckwheat. And then our block of brassicas, summer brassicas, which haven't been so great this year. The brassicas at the other side are doing a lot better. I was just going to show you as well over here. You can see, like, in, I spoke about those early spring winds. So we've kind of left this boundary to go very wild, and we've planted lots of kind of bushes and flowering plants for the beneficial to early pollinators. You can't kind of see them at this time of year because they're not flowering anymore, but we've built up because come early spring, early summer, the northerly winds do blow through here and can kind of affect any early planted crops on the field. So yeah, that gives us a good thick shelter belt, which seems to be working fairly well. So you can see now why we have our sort of daily sort of sitting social space up the top of the field here, because it's just a really nice place to look and sort of look around down into the valley. We have got the packing shed I spoke about. This was like a toilet around the back of my house, sort of toilet and tool shed, which I took down, just reconstructed. So really cheap, easy, quick fix. And actually it's here still 7 years later and going strong. We just built a lean-to on the back, built these shelves for packing, shelving in there for all sorts of stuff. And then tool shed, tiny little tool shed, compost heaps, and then our four polytunnels down here. There's one over the back. So orientation of our tunnels is all north-south. It fits the fields, and yeah, it just fits the space, and it's ideal for the sun crossing over the tunnel, getting to all the plants. So I spoke about the ground is very wet here because it's flat. So we basically dug these channels down the side of all the tunnels, and it takes the water off down into a drain, which then drains off into a gutter along the edge of the field. We haven't done them along both sides with all the tunnels. This was our original tunnel. Well, kind of original tunnel. It has been replaced because we lost the original one in a storm. Then, yeah, you can see these spaces between the polytunnels are incredibly useful. Really sheltered, warm spaces, for particularly for beans and overwintering brassicas and things. So again, the gutters running down both sides of these, outdoor sink, then our tomato tunnel, which we're netting all the ends because we find the blackbirds will get in and just peck away at the tomatoes. So water source, I didn't mention, at this field, we've obviously got a water source here between the tunnels. In every tunnel, we've got a water pipe. Oh, you can see that one just down there at the blue pipe amongst the weeds. So we've got an outlet in every tunnel for ground irrigation for tea tape. And then we have, yeah, a mains down by the gate just over there to the left of the shed. And basically that does, we can access the whole field then with those few taps. So you can see this wet, this sort of flat ground at the top of the field. This time of year it doesn't appear that wet, but look, this is, that is groundwater level, which is pretty much level with our polytunnel, or actually it looks, looking at this, it looks like above it. This is just sitting water right through the summer, that as soon as you dig down, it's, you know, there's a lot of water in there, and because it's clay, the water just tends to sit unless we drain it away. So this area again, the top of the field, which was close to the trees, we didn't want the shade all through the winter on the polytunnel, so we've left probably a good 50 meter gap between the trees and the start of the polytunnels, and this area is just being left to go wild. It's interesting to see there's lots of little trees, willows, willows and oak up in the top corner, a lot of willows and oak starting to self-seed. Our compost toilet is down in the bottom corner. You can see hidden away, but still accessible to our main workspace. And then our last polytunnel, peppers and aubergines. We've got everything covered up with membrane to keep the moisture in and to keep the weeds down. So that's it pretty much. Well, there's going to be a fifth polytunnel going on this ground this winter. And then, what could I, I could briefly show you in here. I spoke about our indoor-outdoor space. So we have a sitting space here where we have school groups, and you know, we come and sit here ourselves if it's wet weather. And this is, you know, that's a good big space. We can fit a lot of school groups. I'll show you some pictures actually of a whole school group crammed into that space. And other than that, working space is on those tables under this huge old oak tree, which there is a risk of bits of wood dropping off it, but actually when it's very hot we tend to just go and shelter and pack under there, or in the back of the packing shed here. So you can see it's all sort of fairly basic, this field. We didn't invest a huge amount of money in getting everything up and running, but everything is actually reasonably functional and working fine. Polytunnels, for instance, there's one new one in the middle, and the others are all pretty much second hand. So I think the one in the middle cost about 5,000, and the second hand ones, once we'd bought all the bits and pieces and covers, and cost about 2,000 each. So I think that's it. I think that is pretty much Websfield, and I hope that's useful to giving you a bit of an idea about how and why we've laid out our sites, why we have. So this is our second site. In a sense, it's a 5-acre site, whereas the other one is 4 acres. This site is much more production, much more of a productive site for us. Our area of the site, basically, like I showed you earlier, there's an 18-acre site owned by the Ecological Land Co-op, which is all this area. We have this 5-acre plot. And then we actually sublet this area, which is about only about a quarter of an acre, to Francesca. She has the polytunnel and this area, and she grows salads and greens for local businesses. And then I'd say a lot of our production for our 130 households, a lot of the bulk of the produce we grow comes out of this area of sort of 4.5 acres or so. You can see we've got a 5-year rotation. So we've got, I always think of it starting with potatoes, followed by brassicas, followed by onions and leeks, followed by roots and friends, followed by a year of fertility building. And I'll show you again a more recent photo of this, which shows the site in sort of full summer production. This was taken earlier this winter. And you can see a bit more of the shape of the landscape from here. Again, that's north. That's kind of looking fairly north. This is like our 1,000 acres of common land runs around that area. And this whole area is like a raised up plateau, which runs around there. And the other field, which we just looked at, Webb's field down in Ilston, is actually down behind, it's probably about 50, 80 metre drop behind those trees down into the valley to where the other field is situated. So looking at how we chose to lay out this site, one thing I didn't say actually, which I should say about the other site, is our polytunnels. We've orientated them all fairly north-south. We've obviously gone with the hedge boundary to sort of help, but north is kind of up this direction, so they've gone fairly north-south, so when the sun comes over, you get the full spread of the sun running up the tunnel. Whereas if your tunnel was running across east-west, if you had tall plants growing in one side of it, you'd lose a lot of the sunlight onto crops at the back. So what to say about this one? Obviously the main road runs up here. So when we started with the site, we decided to put polytunnel just inside the gate for easy access, for checking watering and whatnot, which is a relief after the other site where you've got a long walk uphill every time you come to check watering. Then we tucked the barn in behind the polytunnel just because we wanted to minimise the area that was actually built on, because our plan for this site was to have as much growth area with as little interference from parking and buildings as possible. It's all very level, it's all good soil, it's all really well draining. This area raises up a bit more, there's a bit of a limestone sinkhole there, which means that this is the only part of the site which does dry out a bit. We've put an orchard in this area. We do plan to break this field up into blocks in a kind of agroforestry system. We're sort of working towards doing that with someone, hopefully this winter. So access to water, again, I didn't mention on the other site, but both sites have mains water. So when we came, there was a mains water pipe here, which we've laid pipe all the way along to the polytunnel, and then we've got like an across here into the neighbour site, Trevor and Bettina. That is an issue, that actually we haven't got enough pressure between the two sites. So we're looking at having a second and possibly even third main connections to increase the pressure. So then once we'd run our main water pipe along the edge of the field, we've got standpipes like here, 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 here. So basically for each rotational block, we have a standpipe, and the last one will run to the polytunnel and to this area here. And we've also put one in which runs across here, standpipe there, and then Trevor and Patina have their own standpipes in the field next door. So we basically run water to every area of the site, and then we have enough hose and irrigation pipe to run from any one of those to the end of any of the beds in the entire site, so we can get water everywhere. Aspect and shade. So the shade isn't really an issue in this site. I'm going to quickly drop back to the other site because I realise I didn't say that there. But actually, one thing we did find in Webb's field was with this woodland around the back, we do, in winter and early spring, we lose sunlight. The sunlight comes slowly onto this part of the field. So actually, that's part of the reason why we positioned the polytunnels out so far from the trees, so that they weren't in the shade for too much in the morning. So if we had crops freezing up in the tunnels in winter, they wouldn't have to sit frozen right into mid-morning, midday. They'll defrost very quickly once the sun comes out. Aspect again in this field, we got full sun running across pretty much south, running up all the beds every day. So yeah, that was one of the reasons why we've laid it out, everything in that direction. So jumping back over to Furze Hill, we've actually gone for beds running the other way. The sun is sort of passing over here. And, you know, in theory, if we'd gone with how we'd done it at the other site, we would have run our beds all down this way. But I kind of just felt like it fitted the field and the site better. If we were to run them that way, they would have been extremely long beds, or we would have had to do blocks of beds, which actually in retrospect, now looking back, probably would have worked really well with a kind of agroforestry system, which we're now considering moving over to. We could have had, you know, blocks of trees and shelter, and then beds running, shorter beds running between each of those blocks down the field. If I was coming back to this field now, it's probably how I'd think about designing it. But we've gone with it how it is, and I think we're now going to continue to develop it how it is. Prevailing winds and spring winds, again, similar to the other field. We have very cold spring winds blowing in from the north here. But these, a lot of the crops here we plant later, like it's more of our summer, autumn, winter crops grown in this field. So we don't do very delicate early sowings in this field, so we're not really worried about the exposure. Prevailing winds blow sort of straight up here. Polytunnel's fine, barn is fine. They're protected by the two hedgerows. And generally, you know, we don't have an issue with the prevailing winds on the site. We do nothing is really particularly bothered by them. Tool store is all in this barn. I'll go and show you around in a minute. Parking is just this area here. It does get a bit congested sometimes, and sometimes people park out on the road here, which isn't ideal for villages and buses passing, but sometimes if it gets really busy, we have to put a few cars out there. But we have got enough space to squeeze quite a few cars in the site. Covered workspace for sun and rain. We've got the barn. In wet weather, we can go in there and pack. But we're also going to build a lean-to on the barn, because what we find is in very hot weather, we've got a little umbrella we go under for tea breaks, but we haven't got very good packing space in very hot weather. The barn is okay, but it gets kind of stuffy in there. So I definitely recommend a sort of indoor-outdoor space with walls, with no walls and a roof, where you can get under when it's very hot for like just chilling out and for packing. Wild areas, that's one issue with this field. You know, we use every bit of it. We have let the hedges grow in and grow wilder than they were previously. We've got this area of sort of fairly wild area with an orchard, but that's why we want to bring in this sort of more of an agroforestry style system to build up the wild areas. Oh, sorry about that. Just going to put that back. To build up the wild areas within the field. Play and relaxation. Again, there's not so much play and relaxation. It's a pretty, feels like much more like a sort of busy work site when you're here. When we are relaxing, it's generally in this area. And we have, if we have schools to come to visit, they'll generally gather on this big lawn area here. So that's really nice to keep, you know, kind of a big green lawn area where people can park up and camp as well if they want. And yeah, school groups can come and hang out. Drainage, not an issue at all on this site. It's a little bit wet down this area, but currently we're not doing... We've subsoiled, actually. We did subsoil the field, particularly this area, last year to try and counteract that sort of wet patch. So we'll kind of just see how that gets on. It's interesting, you can see it actually in the picture. This is a much darker green, and actually where the wet area is, just down here, the crops are more yellowing. That's actually a winter green manure crop that's left over before being turned in for roots. But you can see it hasn't grown so well down that area of the field. Views, roads, neighbours. Views from the road, people basically look in and they see Francesca's beautiful salad patch. So that's a bonus to have that in the gate. Lots of flowers and colourful salads. People barely see the barns and the polytunnel now the hedge grows up. They see it more in winter, but not much at this time of year. Neighbours, there's very few neighbours actually looking onto the site. So I don't think anyone's particularly bothered about what we're doing. There are planning applications in for low impact dwellings in here and in here, which, yeah, neighbours are much more bothered about. But even that, I don't think will have a huge visual impact. Permaculture zoning, again, worth looking into. We haven't really taken that into consideration on developing this site, but something I would definitely recommend looking at. So I'm going to show you a few more pictures, aerial pictures of the sites in full summer glory, and I'm going to have a little walk around and just show you a few different aspects of the site which maybe you can't see from here, like the machinery and tractor store over here, which is placed there because it's basically, you can't really see it from anywhere for security reasons. You know, everything's tucked away down that end of the site. So yeah, hopefully that is useful. And yeah, come and have a look around our sites. So the sun's come back out. I'm going to show you our site that we've just sort of talked through. This is the Firs Hill site, which is our much more productive site, owned by the Ecological Land Co-op. I'm going to give you a little tour around to show you how it's laid out. So you can see that we're right on a main, well, not a main road, but a small country lane, which is actually pretty straight and can be very fast. We've only got a small entranceway here. We did think about making it wider, but yeah, we just chose to keep it small. We figured we're not bringing big machinery in and out. It's got a bit overgrown in the summer, but I quite like it. We do need to probably trim it back to make it safer, get pulling in and out. So that's us. Cae Tan's little field, 5-acre field within the 18-acre ELC site. So when you come in, we've got this parking area, Francesca's polytunnel, Francesca's plot, which is looking very beautiful at this time of year. All salads and greens for local businesses. I'm sure my voice is going to be messed up by the wind, but hopefully you'll hear okay. You can just about see the top of Trevor and Bettina's polytunnel over there. They're setting up a low impact development flower growing business over the other side. It's one of our little tractors, which has just got a puncture at the moment. I'm just waiting for the wheel to come back. This is a little Massey 35X that I bought from one of my neighbours, and yeah, it works a treat. So the barn we had built for us all out of Welsh materials, and we had that built the second year we were here in order to store all our tools and have an indoor packing space. So you can see that's all our hand tools, a few sort of sewing machines up there, little kettle and cooker in the corner, benches which we can take in and out. So this is a nice sort of out of the weather place to hang out. And then Francesca's got her like packing corner. We've got our packing corner. We've got a load of junk in a loft, very useful junk, or at some point to be very useful junk. And at the back here, we've built in a potato store, which will store our potatoes for the year, basically, for 130 households. And there's, you know, there's nothing in there at the moment, obviously, because it's not, the harvest hasn't come out of the ground. But you can see that this is like a rat proof mesh, and then we've sealed the walls with like a metal barrier. You can just about see through the back there, and a concrete base, solid concrete base. So it worked last year and remained rat proof all winter. Lots of waterproofs for volunteers and trainees and whatnot. You know, it's a well-used space. It's 10 metres by 5 metres. It cost us about 10,000-11,000 to build. But yeah, incredibly useful space. And then we've got, at the moment, this is the root area of our rotation. And then I might speed you along a bit. That's our very late carrot crop. Around the back here, all sorts of trays and storage, compost toilet, which is essential. We built it onto the back of the barn in this field rather than have it freestanding like in the other field. So after our root section, that's what we've got: parsnips, beetroot, a few salads thrown in, celery, celeriac, fennel, summer beetroot, chard. Then we have a fertility building section that has all sorts in it. There's a beautiful chicory growing, and then we've got lots of vetch, and there were a few brassicas in there, and lots of linseed. There was all sorts in there, but currently the vetch has really taken over, and it's lovely to see. You know, it's always busy with bees and wildlife, and it's really building the fertility for a year on this part of the site. Then afterwards, I'll just show you. So we've got standpipes, water standpipes, for every block all down the side of the field. And we've left our, you know, we leave our hedges come out and just go a bit wild, just so, you know, there's a lot of lovely stuff in there for pollinators and wildlife. So it's nice to leave. And we've also left the hedges go up. We're not trimming them upwards. We're basically just trimming the sides sort of fairly minimally, just to sort of, particularly on the roadside, and just letting the hedges go a bit wild. Then we've got our early potatoes, main crop potatoes. We've got our brassica block, which, kales, cabbages, more kales, there's cauliflowers, purple sprouting and all sorts in there. We do keep this crop cover on everything while it's fairly small to keep birds off and butterflies off. And then once it's well established, we take the covers off and use them elsewhere. We've got a very weedy patch down this end, which is currently under plastic for, well, possibly we'll use it this year, or we might just keep the plastic down there till next year. You can see all the docks coming out on this edge. That's basically what that part of the field was turning into. We've got a big rhubarb patch running down this end of the field. Just walking down to the field next door to show you the last little acre. So we've got about 4 acres in this field, and then an acre next door to make up our 5 acres that we rent here. I'll just show you here through here. This is Trevor and Bettina's plot. We won't go over there now, I'll just show you through the hedge. So they have a 6-acre site there that they're developing as a One Planet development, an OPD. And then in this field, we've got our leeks that have just gone in that are actually getting a bit windblown on the, got some of the, they've got a membrane on them, a biodegradable membrane, which some of them are actually getting covered up by the membrane as the wind blows on them. And then we've got, which isn't great, we're going to have to come back and sort that out tomorrow and weigh them down. Then we've got our machinery store, space for a couple of tractors. This is basically just built out of an old polytunnel and some posts and some reclaimed metal roofing. And then we've got various bits of kit in there and tools for all the machinery. A couple of bits of machinery in the field. And then beds, which are planted through a pipette, because this field is particularly weedy, and that seems to be working really well. And over there, you'll see, I'm just going to go out of the wind so you can probably hear a bit better, but over there we have our lines of compost, which I'm very happy with, as they are, you know, we've got a good couple of years of compost lined up there now. It's always been fairly scarce resource before, but we've got a good few years lined up, and that's basically a mixture of wood chip. This one is pure wood chip, this big pile here, which we've sort of been building up over the last couple of years, and then the other pile, which is covered there, is a mixture of chicken manure, organic chicken manure, horse manure and wood chip. And we've dedicated this part of the site just to composting, so we can have that dedicated area where we can get machinery in and out. There's another access just up this corner of the farm through the field next door. That gives us access basically to bring all this material in easily and to bring a digger in to turn it fairly regularly. That's about it. I think up the top there, there is our little orchard area. I won't take you up there, but I'll take you on a tour of the other field down at Webb's Field. So thank you for listening. Cheers, bye.